complex and lots of long, hard hours to put it together. So what we were able to do is selections. We are going to produce three scenes that are the introduction of Twelfth Night to you. And we are going to be expanding upon this at Ymir. If you get to come to Ymir, please come. We're not exactly sure if we're going to be doing it Friday night or Saturday night, but we will be producing more of this. It'll be an hour's experience that will tell the whole story of Shakespeare's Twelfth Night. So today you're going to see a teaser. And we have been working on this in conjunction with the Commedia that you will see later today. So the group that you are seeing today is from Eferenzi, a tiny subset of Eferenzi. And we have all been working very, very hard, and I want you to know I am extraordinarily blessed to work with extremely talented and dedicated teammates. These are people that work together. None of them is a diva or a star. Every one of them works together to make this production and many, many others come to life. I have never been so blessed in the SCA as to play with a group of people that really believes in producing art together and being a shared team, supporting each other and being there for each other, being flexible, because you know it's hard to get people together in the SCA all headed in one direction. So this is an amazing group of people, and I am grateful that you have come here to give them your attention, because any play that doesn't have an audience is just another rehearsal. So thank you for being here. And I also want to say I am extraordinarily blessed and lucky to have Lilies Among Thorns here, because we just talked a little bit about what we could do together, and they had their own repertoire, and it all came together beautifully. So this is an amazingly talented and experienced bunch of musicians that is going to be bringing all of it together with music today. So thank you so much for being here. Now, how many of you have actually seen the movie, the modern, beautiful movie, Shakespeare in Love?
On the list.
It's like almost required reading for being in the SCA. It's like Princess Bride, right? So when you see it, you will note at the end of the movie, Queen Elizabeth tells William Shakespeare that Romeo and Juliet, that was very nice. And something a little more light for Twelfth Night. So if you imagine Shakespeare's trying to make his living, he's really not in the easiest of professions in Elizabethan England. And he has produced this play in order to be comedic, in order to share jokes, make puns, and liveliness that is part of Twelfth Night, and bring it to Elizabethan England. So that's what you're seeing today. And you may remember that in the movie, Viola is one of the main characters. You're not going to see her today, but you will see her at Twelfth Night. What you're going to see is all the people around her. You're going to see the man, Orsino, that she is in love with. And you're going to see the servants around them, the wacky, crazy servants, and the fool, and the crazy knight, and the uncle, all sorts of people that are around the main character of Viola. So, if you please, enjoy the reminiscing of Elizabethan England as we bring you selections from Shakespeare's Twelfth Night.
Oh, love. thank. Stealing and giving odor. Enough, no more. 'Tis not so sweet a sound as it was before. Oh, love, how quick and fresh art thou, that, notwithstanding thy capacity, thy receiveth is the sea, not interesting. Oh, it falls into abasement and low price. So full of shapes as fancy, that alone is in itself high fantastic.
Will you hunt, my lord?
What, Kyrio?
The heart.
The heart? Why, that I do! The noblest of hearts. Oh, when my eyes did first see Olivia, then I was turned into a heart. And ever since, my desires, like fell and cruel hounds, pursued me. How now? What news?
Good lord, your servant might not be admitted, but her handmaid doth send this reply. The element itself, till 7 years eat, shall not behold her face at ample view, but like a cloister she will veiled walk, and water once a day her chamber round, with eye-offending brine, all this to season, a brother's dead love, which she would keep fresh and lasting in her sad tones.
Oh, she that hath a fine frame of love but to give to a brother? How will she love when the rich golden shaft hath pierced all desires else? When liver, brain, and heart, these sovereign thrones, are supplied by one self-sovereign king? Away to sweet beds of flowers. Love thoughts lie rich on hefty bowers.
Niece to take the death of her brother so. I swear, I do believe that care is the enemy to life.
Well, my troth, Sir Toby, you must come in earlier o' nights. Your cousin, my lady, takes great exceptions to your late hours.
Why, let her expect before expecting.
Your cousin, my lady, believes you must confine yourself to the modest limits of order.
Confine? I'll confine myself no finer than I am. These clothes are good enough to drink in, and so too be these boots. And if they be not, let them hang themselves by their own straps.
This quaffing and drinking will undo you. I heard my lady talk of it yesterday, and of a foolish knight you brought here one night to be her wooer?
Who? Sir Andrew Aguekin?
He.
He's as tall a man as any in Illyria.
What's that to the purpose?
Why, he hath 3,000 ducats a year.
Aye, but he'll have but a year in all of these ducats. He's a very fool and a prodigal.
Fie that you should say so. He can play the viol and the gamboys and speak three or four languages word for word without a book and hath the very good gifts of nature.
Aye, almost natural, but besides that he is a fool, he is a great quarreler. And but that he hath the gift of a coward to allay the gust he hath in quarreling, to set among the prudent, he hath quickly have the gift of a grave.
By this hand, who is they are scoundrels and substractors that say so of him. Who are they?
They, that moreover, add. He is drunk, nightly, in your company.
Take your drinking to the health of my kindness as long as there is passage in my throat and drink in Illyria. He is a scout, he is a coward and a coistrel who will not drink to my niece until his brain turns or the toe like a peristalt. Oh, mensch. Castellago vulgar for here comes to Andy.
Sir Toby Belch! How else, Sir Toby Belch?
Ah, dear Sir Andrew.
Oh, bless you, fair shrew.
And you too, sir.
A cost, knight, a cost.
What's that?
My niece's chambermaid.
Oh, good mistress, a cost. I desire better acquaintance.
My name is Mary, sir.
Good mistress, Mary, a cost.
You must stay, knight. A cost is front her, board her, woo her, assail her.
By my troth, I would not undertake in such company.
Is that the meaning of a cost? Very well, gentlemen.
And now let part so, Sir Andrew, that thou might never draw sword again.
And part so quickly, and I would never draw sword again. One day, though,
you think you have hands in hand? Good sir, I have not you by name.
But you shall, and here's my hand.
Aye, sir. But take your hand, I pray thee, and bring it to the buttery bar.
Good mistress, what's your metaphor?
It is dry, sir.
Well, I would think so. I'm not such an ass, but I can keep my hands dry. But what's your jest?
It's a dry jest, sir.
Are you full of them?
I have them at my fingers' ends. But Mary, I let go your hand, I am barren.
Oh, knight, when have I ever seen you? You lack us a cup of canary. When have I ever seen you put me down so?
Never in life, I think, unless you see canary put me down. Sometimes I think I have no more wits than a Christian or an ordinary man. No, I am a great eater of beef, and I believe that does harm to my wit.
No question.
And I thought to myself, I'll home tomorrow, Sir Toby.
Pourquoi, your knight?
Pourquoi? What is pourquoi? Do or not do. Oh, had I spent the time in the tongues as I did in fencing, dancing, and everything. Oh, had I but pursued the arts.
Then thou wouldst have had an excellent head of hair.
Why, would that have mended my hair?
Past question. But you see, it does not curl by nature.
But it becomes me well, does it not?
Oh, excellent, excellent. But it hangs like flax on a distaff. And I long to see a housewife take you between her legs and spin it off.
Faith, I'll go home. Her niece will not be seen. And if she be, it's for one shall not make. The count himself hard by woos her.
She'll have none of the count. She will not match above her degree, not in estate, nor years, nor wit. I've heard her swear so. There's life in it, man.
I'll stay another month. I'm a fellow of the strangest mind. I delight in masks and revels, sometimes all together.
How are thee at the pechosses?
Faith, I can cut a caper.
And I can cut the mutton. But how are these at the galliard?
How that? Why, the back trip is simply as well as any man in Illyria. But I will not be compared to an old man.
The galliard is that. So, let me see thy caper. Where have these things been hid? Wherefore are these things? A curtain before them. I would as soon, I would see you go to church in a galliard and come home in a coranto. My very walk would be a jig. I would as soon make water as in a syncopace. I do think that by the excellent constitution of thy leg, that it was formed under the star of a galliard.
Aye, 'tis strong. It does well a dun-colored stock. Shall we set about some revels?
What else shall we do? Or were we not born under Taurus?
Taurus, that's sides and heart?
No, that's legs and thighs. Come on, let me see you capable. Yes, excellent. Oh, yes. fine, Heidegger!
Allowed for, though he do nothing but rip. nor no railing, and no discreet man. You do nothing but repent.
You're here to do the releasing, for you speak well of fools.
Madam, there is at the gate a young gentleman much desires to speak with you.
From the Count Orsino, is it?
I know not, madam, but he's a very young man and well attended.
Well, my people call him into bed.
Your kinsman, Sir Tony.
Fetch him off, I pray you. He speaks nothing but mad. Fine, go you, Malvolio. If it be issued from the Count, I am or not at all what you will to dispense. Now you see, sir, how your fooling grows old and people dislike it.
Well, madame, you spoke for us as though your eldest son was a fool, scholar, and friend. Oh, here comes the one who must be a maid.
A gentleman.
What gentleman?
Is there a gentleman? What else?
Oh, how good Sir Toby.
Cousin, how come you so early by this lethargy?
Lethargy? I defy lethargy.
One at the gate.
I marry, what is he?
Oh, let him be the devil if he will. I care not. Give me faith, say I.
No, it's all one.
What is a drunk man like,
fool? Like a drunk? A fool? A madman. The first drop above the peak. The second, that's it. And the third, drowns.
Go now, fetch the ground into cinema. My cousin. He is in the third tree of drink. He is drowned.
He is the mad judge, madame, and a fool. Go, the madman.
Is there anybody in the audience who has their own Shakespeare piece that they would would like to share with us. You are welcome to do so because we have extra time. And in other 12th nights in the past, we have had the opportunity for people to come and bring their monologues, soliloquies, and whatever they have. And people strangely and magically come out of the door. It's as if they had already done some Shakespeare. So I wonder, is there anybody with us today that would like to take the opportunity to share with us some of their own Shakespeare? Okay, well, I tell you, we have the space for another 20 minutes. You're welcome to stay here, and you know, of course, we'll be ready for autographs and commission. But in essence, thank you so much for being here. I really appreciate it, and we've had a wonderful time doing this, so come and see us out of here.